So here's my farming video that I said that's what I was gonna do earlier. It's only been a couple of minutes till the end, after the summoning. I do. Here's how I summon. Here's how I farm. I do one series at a time. So I have to scroll down. Let's start.
Oh my. Utility to turning it off. You could go through effectively the entire game with detective vision switched on, and it would not only make the gameplay easier, but in some sequences it was necessary. And this is a concept that's echoed by several of the developers who said many times in interviews leading up to the game that they had to do a lot of work with detective vision to still make it useful and not feel as though they were nerfing it from the first game. Because after all, Batman still is using it, he's still developing it, and as you would expect, he's likely still using it in day-to-day life, but you still need to fix the problem that you had in the first game where it was so useful that players didn't have a reason to turn it off. And so what they did to fix it was actually fairly sneaky, and I think was very, very intelligent. They made detective vision so that it blurs at long distances, so you can't use it while you're traveling through the city and expect it to work the same way. And while you're traversing specifically, there's no compass on the map, there's no UI to tell you where your waypoint is. They turn all of that off. So really all it's useful for is spotting enemies from a distance while you're traversing, and when you're not doing that, you just turn it off and enjoy the visuals for what they are, which even in 2019 is pretty stunning, I believe. Now, for me, I still feel as though it is overused and still too useful. I found myself using it far more than I would have liked to, not because I just stumbled into it or because I'm incapable of turning it off, but rather because in many gameplay sequences...
Vaughn is better to farm this because of its...
full stealth, which I suppose brings us perfectly to the strange tower. As I said earlier in the video, this is one of the low points in the game for me, specifically because it has such low stakes. From the top of the game, we know that Strange is a major player in Arkham City. If anything, he's the major player in Arkham City. And we know that he's set up to be the primary protagonist. But we know going into this final sequence, as we climb up Strange Tower, we know that this isn't going to be the end of the game because we haven't taken down Joker yet, and that is a major plot sequence that still has to be resolved. As a result, you go into this chapter of the game knowing full well that it's not actually the end, even though everything is trying to point that it will be the end, that this is supposed to be some big climactic finish to the game, and visually it is that. You go up to the top of the tower, you swing around, and the vistas and views are incredible. It's visually probably my favorite moment in the whole game. But in terms of gameplay, it is so boring, it's hard to quantify. The game doesn't do anything different. It just throws a bunch of people with guns up in the tower, you can swing around the outside, then crawl around the inside, slowly picking them off one by one. And if you are looking to spam it, you basically just go to one of the balconies, you hang off the edge, and then you wait for one of the guards to walk up to the edge, you pull them off, and you just repeat that.
You don't have to do it two times.
Now, I'm not recommending that you spam the game.
I usually do one character at a time. Already said that.
Manipulating the mechanic to the point where it can be abused so easily, I don't think that it's saying you should do that. More than anything, it's a criticism of the game for allowing that manipulation to occur. A game like Neo is very aware that players are going to try to just sprint through entire areas to get to the next boss to avoid all of the minutiae of chopping down enemies to rack up souls or whatever the currency is in Neo. And so, in a response to this, they make...
Look at that. All from... All Leo. I'm glad people were smart enough. And thanks to the Reddit. Wouldn't it be funny if they were all like... Franz or Vangs or something. Or Beatrix's. Just a troll. That would have been terrible.
I'm interested in hearing your opinion. Do you think that it's laziness on the side of the developers for not preventing that sort of mechanic? Surely the developers over at Rocksteady are capable of thinking of ways around this. They did it with the Mr. Freeze fight, where they actually made...
I'm staying up all night for him. I don't have a job, so it's whatever.
Which makes me think that it's a conscious decision to leave the ability to use that system in the game. I don't know, leave me more thoughts in the conversation. I'm interested in it. So in summation, I feel that this whole sequence is supposed to, and it's built up visually and thematically and narratively to be this huge climactic moment where everything comes together and you're left feeling super accomplished that you took down the big bad guy who's trying to kill thousands of people. But instead, it leaves you feeling as though you're playing just another small chapter in the game. Awesome. The gameplay does nothing differently. It's like in a movie, when there's a character that's put in a tough situation very early on in the film. And you watch it, and you know that they're in a dangerous situation, but you also know, your stupid brain is like, well, they're the protagonists of the film. They're not going to kill them off in the first 30 minutes.
Look at that loading.
So clearly,
because a whole bunch of people in the server right now.
It's just fine, and it automatically reduces the stakes. And there's no real way to avoid that, except in video games, you have a lot more tools at your disposal. And I suppose.
Look at that lag.
I would be a fool not to bring it up, so. There you go. But beyond these.
This is going to be a short vid because I just wanted to show you how I farm.
Moreover, the aforementioned tools that have been added to Batman's repertoire are a great addition and create all sorts of unique possibilities that I'm still, to be perfectly honest, uncovering every time I go through this game. And this leads me into the idea of generalized combat, which is regular hand-to-hand fighting. And as always, it's amazing. Now, I don't need to discuss the free-flow combat system much at all. You are likely familiar with it, and if you're not, what are you doing watching? Basically, it's highly simplified. There is a strike button, there is a parry button, and then there's many other options for dodging, blocking, rolling, for using different tools, all layering into this base system, which is very, very simple. These systems can be used very poorly, as we saw in the early renditions of it back with Assassin's Creed, but it can also be done very, very well, as it is here. Specifically, what separates that bad from amazing experience is the animation. I don't know what sort of magic they're using over at Rocksteady, but the fluid, free-flow animation system that they use, allowing for all sorts of combos and parries to be tied together seamlessly, where it actually feels as though a person is moving and doing that, it's absolutely phenomenal. What's even more impressive...
Look at that lag.
They doubled the number of combat animations from Batman Arkham Asylum to Batman Arkham City. And then also with characters...
That lag is beautiful.
Revenge DLC... And Catwoman, in her own respective DLC and expansion, all have their own unique, completely original combat modes and systems to be used at your leisure. And I really do feel that the cinematic animations in these games, even going on a decade later, have really aged quite well. If you look at the ending sequence that we looked at earlier with the Joker when he passes away, there's so many subtleties that have been put in here. Look at, for instance, this. His lip twitches in such a delicate but precise way as the last spurts of life are leaving his body. It's such an eerie, creepy, but brilliant detail. I can't even express how much I love it and how impressive it is that this was done back on like the 360, the PS3, in 2011. But moving on, the idea of bosses. This was probably my largest criticism in terms of combat of the original Arkham Asylum game, was specifically that the bosses felt very shallow, just bad. The last fight with Joker is a joke and is frankly terrible. Go watch my critique of Asylum if you didn't see it. I was not impressed. But in this game, they took everything to a whole new level. That was criticism that was immediately apparent when Asylum launched, but the rest of the game was so phenomenally well built that people were willing to forgive them for it. But going into City, you can tell they made a conscious decision to fix that very unique problem. Everything from the Clayface fight to the Ra's al Ghul fight to the Solomon Grundy fight to the Mr. Freeze fight, all are very unique, but don't feel as though they rely purely on a singular gimmick in order to make them work. They're visually interesting and unique and separated from each other very clearly. And they're also, in terms of gameplay and mechanics, very differentiated in terms of the tactics needed to successfully complete them. And honestly, I don't know what else to say. They're just phenomenally well done, and I have to give Rocksteady praise because they knocked this out of the park. Specifically, in contrast with the original game, they came so far from where they started. It is amazing. Now, as for side content, there's a lot to be discussed, specifically with side quests and the Riddler challenges. This game has roughly 20 hours of side content after you finish the main story. For some people who are looking for a completionist run, it could be as much as 30 to 40 hours. As for the Riddler challenges, there are 440 unique challenges.
I don't know why I use his first skill. I need his, I need his other weapon. I'm gonna ticket it.
Before a predetermined amount of time runs out. Now, according to various interviews, we know that these were created and placed into the game towards the end of development, and it shows. The map still feels like a city instead of a confusing mess of corridors designed to hide items. And I like to think of it as an extension of how the Riddler would have developed these puzzles himself, carefully and using what was available to him without manipulating most of the city, just using what was there. It's also important to stress that these Riddler challenges, some very, very simple and some fairly complex, were all designed to encourage creativity and not scouring. It was very important to the development team that they didn't have players trying to find every nook and cranny hoping to find a Riddler trophy as they did in the first game. Rather, that they were completing puzzles and using the tools that were available to them in order to solve puzzles that challenged them and offered some unique gameplay. And as for side quests, there are many things that you can do simply while exploring the world, either during the main quest or just after it. For instance, Deadshot has an entire side quest that you can go on by investigating crime scenes where he's taken out political asylum.
That scared me. I thought his skill was somewhat different, somewhere different, because some people actually do that.
Beyond just these Riddler challenges and the side quests within the core game of Batman Arkham City, from the main menu you can engage in challenge modes, which are also under the purview of
what was that?
Challenges, which allow you to tackle very
what the fuck was that? What the fuck? What the fuck was that?
It's also really fun because you can do these as various characters and in different skins, which offers a little bit of flavor. But perhaps the most important, at least for me, element of Batman Arkham City and what makes it so special is its charm and personality. One of my favorite side quests in the entire game is where you go and you find the Mad Hatter. As I was originally exploring the game world and the map on all sorts of rooftops and on the streets, I was finding picnic blankets, baskets, teacups, and they were left everywhere. Very strangely, but they were always looking towards a specific area. And eventually, if you pursue the side quest, you can find yourself captured by the Mad Hatter, drinking tea with him and his buddies, and engaging in a very unique combat sequence, which visually is probably my favorite Riddler challenge arena. But more than anything, what I love about this is that it's completely optional, and it offers such a unique perspective on the world of Batman. And the world in which you are exploring. It's such a crazy event to just experience that it leaves the player feeling just as baffled as Batman. This is also reflected in the unique dialogue that you find as you travel through the city, and also in the fact that each of the villains are given their own time to shine, and some are developed well beyond what was strictly necessary. For instance, look at Freeze and Nora. Nora, in case you're not aware, is Mr. Freeze's wife, who's also been frozen and has been captured by some goons. Early on in your experience with Mr. Freeze, he asks Batman if he'd be able to go rescue her for him, and at one point you fight Mr. Freeze over this dispute. After the events of the main game, you can either leave Mr. Freeze to himself and not help him find Nora, or you can go actually hunt her down, find her location, take out the thugs that were guarding her and keeping her prisoner effectively, and then go back and tell Mr. Freeze where his wife is, at which point he, it is safe to assume, goes off and rescues her. He thanks you profusely, and it creates a very unique, special, and almost magical moment where Batman is helping somebody who was earlier considered his foe, but he's doing it out of the goodness of his heart, once again, because he rises above it all. And that's why he is such an icon and a hero to so many people. And this care is also shown even to Harley Quinn in the expansion that also comes with the Game of the Year edition, Harley Quinn's Revenge. It's very, very short. You play as Robin, you go through and you take her down, and you play as Batman and Robin. It's fun, it's very, very short, but it really makes you feel for Harley Quinn after she's lost the love of her life. However crazy she is and however weird that relationship was, he was the love of her life, and she lost it. Altogether, the game is phenomenal. It's a masterpiece, and if you haven't played it, you shouldn't have watched this video. You should have gone and played it. In order to understand Batman Arkham Origins, you need to understand how, and more importantly, why it was created. You see, usually when a game is developed, it starts from an idea, effectively a spark from one creative individual or team of them, who all congeal their ideas into one broader concept. From that point, they push and pull with the idea until they eventually have something that they can work with, and at that point they begin to conceptualize how the game will actually
work. Well, I'll be back.
This is true of games that are the first in their franchises.
Hold up.
And also true of sequels that come after story, world, and atmosphere have been established. When this isn't the case, you end up with a game that is incredibly bland and is what we would usually call uninspired. It lacks soul and passion, and there's a notable feeling.
I can get it with the tokens from the Diablo co-op event. I don't use tickets. Oh well. See ya.